acknowledge that the town of Esplanade is found on the lands of the Jagunga people, and they remain traditional elders, owners of this land. And just to acknowledge that it's a privilege for all of us to share in this land and work together with them for the future of our community. Before we go any further, I've just got two apologies tonight. Firstly, from Councillor Sarah Quinton and Councillor Jai Wilson. So they're not able to be here, but we'll listen to the recording and send any questions through to the staff between now and next week. Do we have any declarations from councillors or any of the items on tonight's agenda? Great. Just a couple of announcements. Tomorrow we have an International Women's Day event in the town. It was International Women's Day last week, and we are hosting a morning tea tomorrow at 10 a.m. So that's just to acknowledge all of the work that many of our female leaders do in our community and to honour women and their contributions. We also tomorrow have our annual general meeting of electors, so that is 6 p.m. in the seniors hall, and we encourage anybody who has an interest in what's going on in the town to attend that meeting. And also congratulations to our local member, Mr. Dave Kelly, who was re-elected again on this weekend, and we look forward to Mr. Kelly's support over the coming years in assisting our community to be able to progress our programs, including the Town Centre Master Plan and tree protection. Next we have public question time. So this is an opportunity for any members of the community who have questions on any of the items on tonight's agenda to ask them. Just being mindful that tonight is not a decision-making forum, so it's for councillors and community members to hear more information about the items that will have decisions made next week. So if there is anybody in attendance who would like to ask a question on any of the agenda items, I'd invite you to raise your hand and you can come forward to the microphone and ask your question. Is there anybody who has a query? Yes, please.
I'm a bit short now. As we've already discussed, I'm here just to kind of like voice my opinion on the development of the Bessendine pub. I think it's a fantastic thing, and I really, really do want it to go ahead. My only kind of like contention is the removal of some of the trees. I can't really see the sense in removing a healthy tree and replanting it with a sapling that's going to take 20 odd years to give the same coverage. There are photographs of those lemon scented gums dating back to 1967, and they're already above the roof height of the hotel. If there is any, just to let my feelings and I'm sure a lot of other people's know that if there is any way that we can save the majority of the trees that are already there, that would be fantastic, and it would make a good outcome even better. Thank you.
Thank you. So from speaking to you before the meeting, I understand that your query is really around whether there's any scope to tweak the plans. Is that your question?
Yeah.
And we had a conversation beforehand and discussed that this is a JDAP decision, not a Town of Bessendine Council decision, and that the applicant will obviously be made aware of community sentiment through the feedback that's included in the report, but any other feedback if people attend the actual JDAP meeting itself, and really the decision to make any further tweaks is in the hands of the property owner. Would that be an accurate reflection? Would you like to add anything else?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. The application has been submitted. Council tonight and next Tuesday before it is ultimately considered by the JDAP. If the applicant wishes to make any changes between now and then, that would need to be a request made to the JDAP Secretariat, but the application is currently in train. As I was going to get to later, but I'll press now. Staff have negotiated an outcome, an amended version of the proposal in response to community sentiment about the trees. It would see an additional 2 mature trees be retained, and staff consider that to be an appropriate balance between tree retention, town centre development, and the need to provide a car park.
Great, thank you for that.
So,
yes, sit down.
Carol recital at 55 Broadway, Bassendean. As you know, my strong opinion on trees, so I'm going to cut to an issue which I think the town of Bassendean should consider.
Can I just encourage you to ask a question as part of this?
All right, well, ask you a question.
Thank you.
All right, well, sorry. Thank you. I'm asking the question that the town of Bassendean actually consider providing concessions regarding car parking for that hotel in order to keep our trees. I figure that it would be a good avenue to go down, and I would like to see that happen. And I figure that you guys can go to the developer and sort of say, you know, can we do a bit of compromise? Because I figure they can do it in Sydney, we should be able to do it here in Bassendean. So I'm asking to try a bit harder. Thank you.
Thanks for your question. And just reiterating what Mr. Gibson just said, there have been some conversations today, and feel free to correct me and add anything in. As the report that the staff have prepared outlines, there's already been a parking concessions in order to retain the second victory. Is there anything else you'd like to add?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Not a great deal more to add. In terms of the question, those conversations have occurred and that negotiation has taken place, and like I say, we've managed to, what we think, improve the proposal in terms of striking that balance between tree preservation and car parking. That's obviously set out in some detail in the report. So in terms of the question being, have staff undertaken those discussions, the answer is yes.
Thank you. Any further questions?
Yes, I would like to ask a question, if I may. My name's Sue. I'm from 15 Parker Street. And I would like to ask if there's been any consideration to the fact that there are two entrances and exits to the car park, plus the one for the hotel rubbish, and the bus stop. And I do ask if there's been any consideration to possibly making one of the exits from the car park, closing it off and making it just an entryway at that end.
Yeah, thanks for your question. Are you able to comment on that?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. The application has been assessed from a raft of perspectives, including engineering and traffic management, and the assessment has concluded that the traffic circulation is appropriate. It's not a major departure from the status quo. They're using existing crossovers. In some ways, they're actually reducing those crossovers to reduce the impact on the streetscape. It's not, in determining planning matters, it's not the decision maker's role to redesign the proposal for the applicant. It is the decision to determine whether or not it's acceptable. Staff have undertaken an assessment on that basis and consider the application in its totality, including traffic management and circulation, be acceptable, subject to the imposition of conditions. It's up to council to either agree or disagree with that. If it does disagree, it needs to provide appropriate reasons to do so.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes?
Anne Coulston, 81 Parker Street. Can I just ask, was there any kind of like public discussion, calls for public discussion put out before the staff did their assessments and the design from the new owners was agreed on?
So can I just clarify what you're asked? So you mean seeking feedback from the community prior to the staff assessment?
Yeah, because the first time that I was aware of it was when the email was sent out and there was the designs for the redevelopment of the pub. And then it asked for kind of like submissions, but it seems to me from what you're saying that kind of like that was a bit after that it was already kind of like assessed by the staff. I'm presuming that's town of Bassendean staff in conjunction with the developers, is that correct?
So the report that's included, which will go to the JDEP, has been prepared by our town staff, planning staff.
when was that done? You know, kind of like, what's the time frame? The email about the development came out when, a couple of weeks ago? Was the appraisal by the Town of Bessendine staff done prior to that? After that? Yeah.
Through you, Madam Mayor. Letters were sent out, so I'm not sure about the reference to the email, but letters were sent out as set out in the communication engagement section of the report. We sought public input concurrently with assessing the application. As it became clear that there was some broad community support for the retention of trees, staff undertook concurrent discussions with the applicant with a view to actually arriving at the position we are now. So the short answer is the application was advertised quite quickly after it was submitted and it was concurrently assessed by town staff.
Okay, must have missed the letter, I only got the email.
Well, I am actually going to ask if there could be more community consultation, because when Hawaiian decided they were going to develop the shopping centre, there's a lot of trees that had to go. And the company, Hawaiian, were prepared to contact me and wanted to tell me what they were intending to do. So I think if Hawaiian managed to do, you know, talk to the residents here in Bessendine about what their intentions were of cutting down so many trees, I think it would be good if we could get the hotel to have a discussion, because I think the hotel owners would then appreciate the fact that people really do care about those trees, and it'll be a good business model for them, because it'll be a shady place to park, go to the pub. Anyway, can we try a bit harder, please? Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. So there's a couple of these points being covered already, but I suppose the application for council tonight relates to the Bessendine Hotel, one of the most recognisable buildings in the district, and one that sits on a prominent corner in the Bessendine Town Centre. The application seeking approval for various additions and alterations, including the removal of the drive-through bottle shop, provision of new courtyards, and general heritage restoration. As I said earlier, council will not be making a final decision on this matter. It will be determined by a joint development assessment panel, but will have regard to both the staff's responsible authority report, as well as any recommendation that council chooses to make on the matter. If council chooses to depart from the staff's responsible authority report, appropriate reasons need to be provided. In terms of the application itself, obviously the main issue at play is the retention of existing trees on the site, and how that intersects with the need to provide car parking. As stated in page 7 of the Responsible Authority report, the trees are located on private property and are not subject to any statutory protections at the moment, and therefore can be removed without any development approval. Whilst 3 tree preservation order nominations have been received very recently, they're yet to be determined by council, and therefore no statutory protection exists. In any event, as I've previously said, staff discussed the matter with the applicant with a view to retaining additional trees on site, and have reached broad agreement about a number of conditions that they will accept, which will see a slight reduction in the number of car parking bays, but will allow for the retention of 2 existing trees. This is considered a very positive outcome, one that balances the need to provide car park to support the use, the desire to support town centre development at a time when we're doing a master plan, and also the desire to retain trees on the site. If approved, it's hoped the application, or hope the development, will be a catalyst for future development of the town centre, and it's recommended that council support the staff recommendation.
Thank you very much. Councillor Hamilton?
Thank you for that, Mr. Gibson. I just have a couple of questions, and I do take on board your comment previously that we are not here to design the plan. So forgive me if I do tread into that territory a little bit, but I note in the report that there's really 173 bays less than what would normally be required under the current planning scheme. And I also do take on board your comments that subsequent negotiations with the developer have resulted in the retention of two more trees, including the second fig tree, which is good. I'm very pleased about that. But it occurred to me this afternoon when you sent through the actual schematic drawings, looking at the driveways and the parking bays, and coming a little bit into what one of the people in the gallery mentioned before, that the entry and exits, if there was an entry through, say, one side street, Wilson Street, with the exit at the other street, which is Parker Street, would it be potentially possible for the applicant to get more car parking bays in there if they did angled parking?
Through you, Madam Mayor, angled car parking is typically an inefficient way of providing car parking.
That's why I asked.
Because you have the triangular bit of space that typically results. The application has been assessed by the town's engineering staff and it's deemed to be acceptable. There would be no mechanism for the town to enforce angled car parking.
Oh, I'm not saying force. I was just curious about whether that had been thought of or considered by either the developer or the town staff, because I was looking at the plans and it did occur to me, I wondered whether that was a more efficient way to operate that car park, and would it result in getting more spaces? Given the shortfall in parking, would it result in more car parking bays for the applicant? So that was one question. And of course, carrying on from that, if the developer gets more car parking spaces, would that incentivise retention of, say, one more tree? These are my thought patterns. I don't know how legitimate they are in planning terms, but you know, it is the way I'm thinking.
Through Madam Mayor, like I said, the angled parking is typically an inefficient way of providing parking. There is also the practical challenges of the site being the topography. So the applicants have made an assessment of the lay of the land, determined that perpendicular bays are the most appropriate. They meet the Australian standards. Obviously, the issue in terms of compliance is the number of bays, but as set out on page 3 of the RAR, staff consider it's appropriate to grant a variation to those requirements. In terms of what would incentivise the developer, it would be a bit difficult to comment on that, but I would go back to my previous point and say that staff have certainly tried to negotiate with the applicant to result in a better outcome than what was originally submitted, and we think we've achieved that.
Can I just for everybody's clarity, you referred to if council wasn't to support all agenda, there need to be appropriate reasons provided. So my understanding is that those reasons need to have a planning basis, and the town's desire to retain trees is not an appropriate planning reason for an application to be refused. Is that correct?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Yes, that's correct. Trees have no statutory protection at this stage, so if council was to not support the application, it would need to be a reason that does not relate to the trees.
And if an application is rejected on grounds that don't have a sound planning purpose, the applicant would then have the avenue to appeal the decision when it's withdrawn as a JA decision.
Through you, Madam Mayor, what would more likely happen, as opposed to getting through to a SAP process, is that the JDAP itself would be unlikely to prosecute an argument against an application if it was not based on planning reasons. So it would be unlikely to even get to the appeal stage.
Right, thank you. And can I just ask, so the concerns that community members have been raising are largely around the trees. It's great that there's been negotiation to retain the second fig tree and the eucalyptus closest to the Chinese restaurant lead. So the other two trees that are on the boundary, can you help us to understand the rationale of why they can't be retained, given
they don't need to provide a reason to council nor the JDA as to why they should be removed. It is not a matter that's to be considered by the decision.
Thank you. And just for, I've got a question on behalf of Councillor Quinton, who's not here obviously. Over the years, one of the things that's been raised about the existing Bassendean Hotel has been its poor disability access. In the process of redeveloping it, I understand that there's a requirement to comply with the current disability standards. Is that correct?
Thank you. As part of the building permit process, I'll be making extensive modifications to the internal of the building to comply not only with the Building Act itself, but also the public building regulations. So a lot of the internal access ways will need to be modified to accommodate disabled access to the building. The only exception being there's one lounge area that they're not required to retain access to, simply because it was part of the original fabric of the building and doesn't connect to any emergency exits. So otherwise, yes.
Any other questions? Just before you have a question, Councillor Hamilton, do any other councillors have questions? Hi, Councillor Hamilton.
I note that this went to the design review panel where there were some recommendations about historical features and also landscaping. Would the staff be able to help me understand with the retention of these two extra trees, is the landscaping plan reduced for the planting of further new trees? Because bearing in mind we've got the consideration of the town's policy for one tree for every four car parking bays. So I'm trying to understand whether, because we have now negotiated to retain two extra trees, is the landscaping plan further reduced for planting new trees?
Through you, Madam Mayor, it's not reduced, but the retention of trees would count as a credit if there would be a tree on the site. It wasn't really a matter that was sort of firmly in the DRP's wheelhouse. The DRP dealt more so with the actual fabric of the building as a heritage place. But in terms of the landscaping plan, there's a series of conditions I draw your attention to on page 10, which are conditions 4 and 5 that set out what the obligations are for the developer, and that is to retain the additional two trees, being tree 1 and tree 5. But also condition 5, Roman numeral 3, there's a requirement for additional trees on the southern boundary. And it, we would anticipate the actual site would accommodate over 20 new trees. Under these conditions, a combination of them, in addition to what's being retained, the site is likely to accommodate the vicinity of 20 additional trees. And those trees, I'll just jump back to one of the questions earlier about a reference to a sapling. The trees need to be provided to a minimum height of 3 metres upon planting.
Thank you. Do you have a further question?
Yes and no.
Do I stand up? I forget. Just a brief question, if I may. Anecdotally, to what extent do you feel confident that the developer is aware of the town's community values and the value we place on trees?
Through you, Madam Mayor, I'll say acutely aware. they approached the town for an informal pre-lodgement meeting before they actually lodged their application. Walked us through without any plans, but just sort of verbalised what their intention was. We made it abundantly clear at that meeting that if there was going to be any issue with the trees, that would probably lead to a spike in community interest. So they are absolutely aware, and we've made them objections, it was relatively little. That notwithstanding, we understand the trees are an important issue, and that's sort of embedded in the SCP, as is town centre development and heritage restoration. So there are a couple of competing things here. And I suppose I go back to that comment about striking the right balance between those competing objectives, and we think we've done a good job of that.
Yeah.
This is probably just a question. In the report somewhere it mentions that our precinct structure plan is yet to be made. When's the schedule for that to actually eventually be completed?
Through you, Madam Mayor, councils will be aware of the broad review of the local planning framework, which we are in the relatively early stages of. In any event, the requirement for a precinct structure plan for the town centre only materialised about a month ago. So I would suggest that body of work, which would be not immaterial, would certainly need to occur following the strategy, the scheme, and the master plan. If you go and look at the recommendations contained in the draft local planning strategy, there is a recommendation to a generic framework for the town centre. It wasn't precise as to what it should be, because at the time we prepared it, precinct structure plans were mandatory. Obviously, we now know that the framework, which was foreshadowed to be an activity centre plan, precinct plan, or policy, will be a precinct plan. And that will replace LPP1. So couldn't put a definitive date on it, except to say that it would occur after those other three projects.
Okay, no, that's fine. I just was curious, I think.
All right, everyone happy if we move on? Thank you for that. So item 7.2, it's the new lease for Castlemere and Montessori Community School. And thank you for Janet and the board members for being here this evening.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. This item seeks Council's consideration of a series of actions to resolve an issue with the existing lease to Casimir, which, as set out in the report, is actually invalid as it relates to the portion of BIC Reserve that the school occupies. So it has been recommended that Council agree to the steps set out in the dot points on the bottom of page 9, which broadly seeks to correct the issue without making any fundamental changes to the existing lease. It is effectively a tidy-up of an administrative error from a number of years ago, and will provide the school the security of tenure until the end of 2027.
Can I just ask a question? On the bottom of page 9, in section ends of purpose, there's the comment about needing it to be and wanting to include community purposes. This is probably sort of the greatest area of interest for members of our committee. Can you just provide us a definition of what community purposes is and how that might be implications maybe?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. We don't have a definitive definition in our discussions with the department. They haven't provided one. It was the department's suggestion to resolve this issue by way of adding community purposes. It's not, from the town's perspective, it's not envisaged to change or not intended to change the purpose of the lease, but it would provide the minister the ability to actually approve the lease. At the moment, the minister cannot approve the lease because the purpose of the lease is inconsistent with the purpose of the reserve, and this would just be an administrative task to allow the lease to be approved by the minister. What it would allow, as I say, the department hasn't given any definitive indication of that, principally on the basis that we haven't felt the need to bend that down, because we're not looking to change the use of the reserve. We're not looking to allow more things or different things to take place there. We're simply looking to correct an administrative mistake from a few years ago.
Any questions, councillors? Councillor Hamilton?
In the attachment with the lease, and it's page 18, clause 22B, I note that the tenant acknowledges that the landlord will only consider selling 11 Hamilton Street, Castlemere to the tenant on such terms and conditions as the landlord requires if A, the tenant purchases 16 Whitfield Street, Castlemere, or B, the Crown disposes of the portion of the BIC leased as part of the premises. this is a tiny little detail, but it doesn't actually say that the Crown is obliged to dispose to either the town of Bassendine or the tenant. It just says Crown disposes of, and it's a minor thing because I think, but I just wondered about that, whether that actually needs to be clarified. It's very minor. You don't have to answer now.
Through you, Madam Mayor, I can understand Councillor Hamilton's point. I suppose that would need a bit of further investigation, but I suppose going back to the earlier comments, we're not seeking to rewrite the lease and correct all the anomalies. There is a key issue here that has prohibited the lease from being approved by the Minister, and we have tried to keep it as similar as possible to allow as smooth passage as possible, but certainly accept that.
Yeah, it's to my mind, it's a minor thing because I think we are all aware of the intent. The other one too with the lease, which is kind of interesting, is under rent review, it's got CPI annually, and generally there is, before you go into an option period, there's usually a proper rent review or market review, but I don't see that in there, but maybe I missed it.
Through you, Madam Mayor, we'd have to take that one on notice.
If it's not part of the lease, I just wasn't sure if I'd actually missed it. So,
Mr. Gibson, I'll take a look and get back to you.
Yeah.
After the meeting. Any other questions from other councillors? Is that it for you, Councillor Hamilton?
Yeah.
So then, item 7.3 is the road dedication lot 55.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. This item relates to a reasonably innocuous main administration matter whereby the existing Christie Way verge is actually a public access way rather than a road reserve, and the report simply provides Council the opportunity to rectify the issue via the Minister for Lands. So no major strategic implications.
Any questions?
Okay. This one, okay. I understand the logic of what's put in front of me with the report. It's very logical. So my question is probably a bit out of left field. Given that it's a commercial premises on the western side adjoining residential on the eastern side with Christie Way in between, can staff provide information on how the residential properties adjoining Christie Way will be protected from commercial truck movements, particularly if a supermarket loading dock is constructed on the western side right next to Christie Way? I'm just curious about how you might manage that.
Through you, Madam Mayor, that would be considered at the development application stage or at the local development plan stage if the landowner elects to go to that path first. Like with a number of other applications, even the hotel site, they need to be assessed from a traffic and manoeuvring point of view, as well as a local residential amenity point of view. So that would certainly be considered. And I think from memory, the concept plans that were provided in late 2019 had the access coming off Ivanhoe Street as opposed to the more local Christie Way.
Yeah, the only reason was that those original plans, it also looked like the trucks would leave by Christie Way given an opportunity. So that's why I ask.
Through you, Madam Mayor, the short answer is it would be a genuine consideration of the development approval stage.
Okay.
Thank you. Any other questions, councillors? Okay, so item 7.4 then, it's the draft local planning policy on aggregated car parking and trip facilities.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. This report is asking Council to consider an amended local planning policy related to car parking. Council does have a current policy, but it has not been reviewed since its initial adoption in 2008. The draft amended policy seeks to provide greater clarity in terms of requirements, particularly in relation to bicycle parking, end-of-trip facilities and rideshare opportunities, but also provide some flexibility to consider matters on a site-by-site basis as appropriate. The draft policies remain largely unchanged from what was distributed to councillors last month. And it's important to note the recommendations only seek council support to advertise for public comment, and if council agrees to do so, it will be advertised and we will back the council for a subsequent decision.
And thank you for answering my numerous questions today on this. Do other councillors have questions? Anyone other than Councillor Hamilton first?
Okay, just another quick question. It mentions a payment in lieu parking plan is intended to be created sooner or later. So is that also going to be after the strategy is developed, processed, whatever you call it?
Through you, Madam Mayor, we are required to have a, where we have one. Okay, through you, Madam Mayor, we don't need to have such a plan, but the mechanism for the plan to exist occurs in July, so at any point from July onwards, we could have, council could adopt such a plan, but I'll suggest, as you alluded to, given that most of the opportunities for shared reciprocal parking will exist in and around the town centre, at the very least, it should wait until the conclusion of the master plan, which conveniently will be in about June or July anyway. So once we have a council endorsed master plan, we can consider the merits of the changes to the regulations and decide whether it's something we need.
In the Office Recommendation 0.3, there's the draft long-term financial plan that goes out to the 23-24 financial year. So I'm interpreting that to mean that we do the planning work in the next 12 months, but then the actual implementation we're not expecting to be complete until mid-24, is that?
Yes, correct. Unless there's an opportunity to establish the sort of parts that depends on what the final looks like.
Okay. So the $150,000 following financial year, what would that be for?
Just the estimate of the minimum cost to do this sort of plan, I guess, as the standards we've talked about so far, would be about $500,000. So rather than trying to find this money in one rush, we have to get some of us to be able to be able to do those works.
Right, that makes sense. Thank you. Anyone else first? Councillor McWilliam?
My question is about the page 22 of the agenda regarding the potential future riverbank funding opportunities. And in the second sentence, you say there may be an opportunity to apply for a riverbank grant to support the natural rehabilitation elements of a restoration of the river. This is my sort of like extending that. Obviously, the restoration of the banks of the river will improve, will have an impact on the actual water itself. But I think it's worth making some sort of distinction so that people, you know, I look at it and go, yes, let's do the water as well, which of course is not on the cards, is that correct, at this point?
What this plan would be doing is stabilising and restoring the edge of the river bank. Would like to include forestry plantings such as sedges and rushes. So we'll be looking after the area from the high tide mark upwards, essentially. But
Yeah, I just wanted to know, with the splitting of this funding, I'm assuming this is because it's a small, this is a small council, and you're projecting forward that we may not have the funding to do it all in one hit. But my question is, in practical terms, are there savings to be made if we had adequate funding once the planning's all done to actually do it all in one hit? Are there savings to be made in that respect or not? Yeah, I read that in there, and that also is a good strategy as well. Thank you for that.
Any other questions? Yes. All right. Okay, item 7.6, which is the town's waste plan. That'll be why you're with us this evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor and Assistant CEO, for allowing me to introduce this item. The waste plan incorporates the town's aspirations and meets the state requirements. The plan details our previous in diverting materials from landfill and creates an opportunity to promote our successes, such as changing to FOGO collections. The plan provides a 5-year horizon for the town's planned actions to improve its waste services and includes reviewing the recycling collection service, reviewing the town's collection contracts, tackling illegal dumping and litter, and trialling recycled material in the town's infrastructure, and many more actions. Following endorsement by council, the waste plan will be submitted to the Department of Water and Environmental Regulation for approval.
I think you can work on this. Any questions, councillors? Councillor Hamilton?
Thank you. I had a short conversation with the officer before we start the meeting, so thank you for clarifying some of my points. I'm just curious about contamination levels in the FOGO material, and I know that there has been discussion with the administration, EMRC, about ways and means of reducing that level of contamination. So I just wanted to know if you've settled on a path forward on that. Is it just going to be solely education, or will there be some sort of because we clearly have some repeat offenders in this area.
Yeah. So. Yeah, there's a number of tools that we can use to help improve the quality of the FOGO feedstock. Some of them are operational, such as peeking through the material at the processing facility. There's not the opportunity to do that during the trial facility, but EMRC are looking to introduce that in the more permanent facility. There's also a contamination process going on where we have 4 warnings way where they can actually lose the service, and then broadly we're going out and educating people as to what the right thing to put in the right bin. There's a number of ways that we generally do that.
Okay.
Thank you. Questions? Thanks for that, Bryce. Item 7.7 is the revocation of several council policies.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. This report is part of the broader review of policies occurring all of last year. It asks Council to consider revoking 5 existing policies as listed in the report. None of the policies have been reviewed in the last 7 years, and they're not required, and it's recommended that they be revoked.
Yeah. you, Your Worship. It's not so much a question on the budget, but more a comment that I've had from a number of community members. Just while we're looking at the budget, I'm just wondering if I can see if we've looked at the situation. I had contact from about five community members after the last council meeting, saying that the audio from this chamber was shocking. Thankfully, the only person they didn't have problem hearing was myself. But and Councillor Hamilton, I think they said you had wonderful projection as well.
Wow.
So I guess what you're asking is there a budget allocation to
address
that?
Correct, yes. Or are we, obviously,
I
Mr.
I think this is part of the IT
review
as well, is that correct? Am I being correct?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Yes, it is part of the IT strategy.
Just one further on that from me. The microphones that are here, I know these ones are not and that one is not, are they projection microphones or are they just for the recording microphones? Recording.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
I just have a question for a previous agenda item. My apologies, it's taking a minute to catch up, if that's right. Otherwise, I can ask it. It's just in relation to the revocation of temporary holiday accommodation in caravans.
Please hold that just for a second. Are there any more questions on the budget item? Feel free to ask a question.
Thank you. It's just a brief one. What currently, if a friend or family member wanted to stay in a caravan on a person's property, what would be the process that they would need to undertake? And if the policy was revoked, what would that look like?
Through you, Madam Mayor, it would depend on the intended length of tenure. From a planning point of view, they would be able to basically undertake the use or the occupation for up to 48 hours without any need for a valid approval. If it was longer than that, they would need approval of a short-term accommodation or similar. But there's also separate legislation, being the Caravan Parks and Camping Grounds Act, that applies. So there is no straight answer because it will depend on the length of tenure, and there will be one or two approvals required depending on the specific case.
Mm-hmm. I suppose the probably more of a comment now, but I suppose the motivation behind my question is at the moment there's a chronic shortage of social housing and homelessness accommodation, and I'm aware that members of the community that are homeless or disenfranchised often use caravans as a mechanism to get some shelter. I would just be interested to see if the revocation of this policy would have an impact on the ability of community members to provide that.
Clearly, Madam Mayor, short answer is no, it wouldn't compromise the ability to accommodate that form of activity. Just from anecdotal experience in the last 18 months, we haven't received an application, and talking to some of the longer standing staff here, they can't recall ever receiving an application. That is not to say it doesn't occur, but this sort of thing is normally brought to the town's attention via compliance action, and it may well be that these things are occurring in isolated spots throughout the town with little or no impact, which doesn't lead to any sort of notification to the town, and therefore we don't receive an application. The use still continues and the activity occurs with development approval, but in such a way that it's not impacting anyone else around.
Is that it?
That's it.
Okay. Item 7.9 is the monthly financial report.
This is the payment figures.
I don't really
think
particularly say about the monthly financial report and the next one I think is the payment figures.
Yeah. payment figures, yeah.
Okay, so there's no questions about the monthly financial report, so we're on to 7.10, which is the accounts paid for February 2021. Councillor Hamilton, you have a question about accounts?
Yeah, I just have two questions. One is EFT 42720, and I note that we've paid 4,000.
Which page is that on, Councillor Hamilton?
Sorry? That is page 2 of 11. And it relates to membership fees for garage sale trail, $4,287, and that's for this year, and the garage sale is in November. I wasn't sure where we stood with that. I didn't think we had approved events for the coming financial year, so I'm just curious about that. You don't have to answer now, it can be on notice.
Yes, one of my colleagues has an answer, I'll take it on notice.
On notice.
Get back to you on that one.
Yep, no, that's fine.
Second.
And the second one is EFT 42838. And I note that we spent almost 18,500 on mowing for various sites. And my curiosity is spiked on that because we've been purchasing our own in-house mowing equipment and what have you. I'm just curious about the amount of expenditure that we're spending with a contractor, but again, you can send me an email on that. So.
Yeah, I'll need to do that. Thanks.
Great, thank you for that. Okay, item 7.11 is the outdoor eating facility, the parklet. We have a permit modification for the parklet that's going to be approved outside of O2. Okay.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Councillors will recall that we previously granted approval for a parklet on Old Perth Road and issued a permit under the trading local law. The applicant has since sought to obtain a liquor licence from Racing, Gaming and Liquor. Racing, Gaming and Liquor refusing to issue the licence on the basis that they're concerned that the licensee would be unable to evict intoxicated patrons from the licensed area in the event that they were complying with the requirements of the permit. They've advised that if we modify condition number 3 on the permit to remove reference to it being publicly available at all times, they'll be able to issue the licence.
And that's the only change that's been proposed. Any questions? Councillor Hamilton?
That's fine with the report. I just have a couple of things. I know that some of the other councils, and I have not had time to go back and look at the parklet policy, but there's some conditions for parklets that are going to have alcohol consumption with a lot of other councils, and that includes being able to limit the trading hours for alcohol. So I note that in the report you were looking at those trading hours coinciding with the existing O2 trading hours, which are, I think, are 11 in the morning till 11:30 at night or something like that, or 11 p.m. at night. So my question is, would it not be wise, given it's a parklet that's outside, would it not be wise to actually curtail that serving of alcohol to the outside parklet half an hour before closing so that alcohol can be consumed and people can leave that area rather than hang around after the business is closed? So would administration take that on board?
You, Madam Mayor, there's no ability in the local law to prescribe trading hours. In terms of the liquor licensing hours, Racing, Gaming and Liquor is responsible for that on their Section 40 and Section 39 certificates, and it's part of their licence. So unfortunately, we can't restrict hours in which they would trade in that respect as part of this permit process.
Okay, that's that's interesting because I looked at City of Vincent policy, and they actually, in their policy, have the ability to limit the hours for alcohol serving at parklets. But that's another one.
If I could, Madam Mayor, sorry, Councillor Hamilton. I'm just looking at the Council's recently adopted alfresco dining and public trading policy. And in relation to alfresco dining, which is not a parklet per se, but it is a relevant consideration, it says, unless otherwise specified by the town, hours of operation may be determined at the discretion of the permit holder, subject to compliance with any liquor licence conditions. So going back to Donna's comment about the department determining all things alcohol related, we suggest that should also occur here.
Okay.
I do have another question about public liability insurance. Does their public liability insurance, I know it covers the parklet, but does it cover when people are walking between O2 and the parklet along the footpath, or is that our public liability insurance? Because clearly there can be some conflicts happening with traffic going in and out of the restaurant to the parklet, so I'm curious about the public liability in that respect.
Through Madam Mayor, the footpath remains in the care and control of the town, so the policy position and the associated approval council previously issued was about the public liability in relation to the parklet itself, so that doesn't change the town's responsibility to manage the footpath environment.
Mm.
Any other questions, councillors? Okay, so that's all the reports, so we are done for this evening. So we'll finish the briefing at 7 o'clock, which is pretty much record time, and see you back here for AGM, not here.
Multiple questions.